Through the years, and I just commit him. Amen. this church, amen. Lives have been changed. Lives have been saved because of his preaching. Amen. There are the witnesses in the house, amen. So I thank God for him. I thank God for his spirit. I thank God for the way he greeted me. And he took me back there and set me down and said, now, this is not my church. This is not my pulpit. This is the Lord's house.
Amen.
And he said, you preach. And you preach on crooked preachers, then they can't get mad. You're not preaching to me, but if they are crooked, they need to straighten up. So he gave me the okay to preach. So, and I thank God for his spirit and God for him. Amen. I want to introduce my wife, Robin. Amen.
Amen.
From all over in Alabama just to get me. Okay, son, you can stand now, okay. my son, Corbin James, amen. Thank God for my family, amen. That's just a partial, amen. But I thank God for them for supporting me and having my back. Too long. I know this is first Sunday, and I know first Sunday y'all have meals already prepared, and so we want to do what God has called us to do. Amen. Amen. So glad you're here. I'm glad you didn't come because of me, but I'm glad you was here when I got here. Let's go ahead and preach and sit down so we can enjoy the rest of the day. Amen. I want to call your attention this morning. Psalm 37. Very familiar passage of scripture for those who read their Bible. Amen. Psalm 37. Neither be thy envious against the workers of iniquity. For they shall soon be cut down like the grass and wither as the green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good, so shall you dwell in the land, and verily you shall be fed. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way unto the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. I want to stop right there. I want to talk on this thought today. Godly advice. Godly advice. Not my advice, but godly advice. Amen. Say it. Say godly,
godly
advice.
Advice.
Amen. We look at the first word of this text when it says fret. Fret, defined it as worry, fuss, agonize, trouble, bother, upset, hassle. Look at the next word, it says envy. It defined it as jealousy, resentful, spiteful, grudging. Amen. And what happens to us so many times is we look around at other people, and they are not living right. They are rude, they're selfish, they're disobedient to God and to the laws of this country, but they are being successful and prosperous. They do not seem to struggle at all. They get the job promotion. They drive newer cars and they live in nicer homes. They go on better vacation. And from outside looking in, they are living the dream life. If they do get in trouble with the law, they get a slap on the wrist. But if it was us who was doing those things, we get caught, they would throw us under the jail. You can't help looking at these people with their big salaries, 2 to 3 story homes, pools and boats and different car to drive every week if they wanted to, and not be a little jealous and a little envious, I think we would have. And it came, and it can begin to upset us, Mariah, to bother you that there are so many people out there that don't have the care in the world. And here you are trying to live a right and do right life. And all you get is trouble and heartache. It's easy. It's easy to worry about and or focus on. But others have got and have, they have received and what they have in their possession. It's easy to focus on that. But the one thing that aggravates us is that deep down inside of us, we secretly wish we could be doing what they are doing. Amen. Am I right about it? Getting away with it. You remember the prodigal son, brother, the prodigal son's brother. No, not the prodigal son, but his brother. Amen. Luke 15 and 30, to be exact. But as soon as this son of yours came, who was devoured in livelihood with harlots and did everything out of the will of God, and when he came home, you killed the fattest cow. That was the brother that was jealous and envious of what his brother had did. And when he came home, his daddy decided to give him a party. His brother was envious. He didn't know that, but that's what he wanted to do. He left home. That's what really upsets us, is that what really aggravates us. We think that they are getting away with something, and something we wish we were doing. Now you catch that. Can I say it again? We think they're getting away with something that we wish that we were doing. Corey Ten Boom said it like this. He said, look around and you'll be distressed. Look within and you'll be depressed. Y'all didn't catch that because I didn't know amen. Let me say it again. Corey Ben Boom said it like this. Look around and you will be distressed. Look within and you will be depressed. Look to the Lord and you will all have rest. Okay, all right. For they, the Bible says, for they shall soon be cut down like the grass, as withered as the green herb. The reason we don't need to get upset or fret about what these people are getting away with or not being punished for, it seems that they are getting blessed and we are being cursed. We have to remember that what God has in store for the Christians is different than what he has in store for the non-believers. Come on, somebody. The same fire that can warm you can also be the same that burn you. Amen. I wish I had some help here. And for some, they have maybe doing well in life and not doing well in the next life. Amen. The rich man Lazarus, y'all remember him? He had everything in life, but only he had his memories in the next life. He had comfort in his life and pain and suffering in the next life. What does this mean? Just like the burning bush that Moses saw. It was burning, but it didn't burn up. It didn't dissolve or disintegrate. That means people will burn, but they won't burn up. I wish I had some help here. There won't be any relief for the pain and the suffering. We must understand that if we're not living the God life he wants us to live, that we're going to a place where the Bible says that she enlarges herself. In other words, there's plenty of room in hell for you. Am I right about it? Yeah, that's what the Bible says. When someone is suffering and they pass away, people will say, well, At least they are at rest. But when people wind up in hell, they are the dying but no death. Come on, somebody. When you die, amen, somebody, and there's no death, that means there is no escape. So don't be jealous of people here on earth. Yes, they may be doing good here, but they won't. But what about when this life is over?
Amen.
How are they going to do in eternity?
Amen.
Not things, whether it be clothes, cars, houses, trinkets that we gather, riches that we accumulate, land that we purchase, trophies and awards that we are awarded, they all are temporary.
Amen.
Let me serve notice if I can. If I can serve notice on you today. You the ones that have a cabinet full of china, you better start using it. Those forks and spoons that you have that you don't want nobody to eat out of to Thanksgiving or Christmas, you better use it. You can't save it. You can't take it with you. You better use everything you got in your house, because when you dare to go, they put you in the ground, throw dirt in your face. Somebody go into your house and take everything out of it. Quit storing everything in your house. As a matter of fact, I put it like this. The Bible says, don't store your treasure up here. Yeah, on earth. But because what's going to happen, somebody else is out there get old and rust and all that other junk, get up on it. Somebody else is going to come and take it anyway. You better use everything you got. Quit trying to hold on to it. Well, the only thing that matters is when it's all said and done, is where will you spend eternity? But let me give you three things. Let me give you some godly advice that the Bible shows us here. The first thing I see here after this introduction, the Bible teaches us that, first of all, we need to trust in the Lord. It is right there. Don't you see it there? It's right there in verse 3. It says, trust in the Lord. That's what it says there. He says, trust in the Lord, but also, he said, and do good. You cannot trust in God and not do good. If you want to reap the benefits that God has for you, you got to not only trust him, but you got to also do good. Am I right about it? We must understand that we have put our trust in things that does us no good. What is trust? Trust says here that it is belief, it's reliability, truth, ability, strength of someone or something. That sounds like trust in God to me. Come on, somebody. You was in Sunday school this morning. He had to trust the Lord and what God told him to do. He told him to take his son and put him there and so you can sacrifice him. But because of his trust in God, the Bible says that the Lord said, hold up before he killed his son. And when that means he had trust. That's a good model of a person who has trust in God. We put our trust in so many things that's not of God. Am I right about it? We trust things that we don't even realize that we trust. Can I help you? Some of you came to church this morning and some of you had to take the highway. Matter of fact, I just use me as an example. I came all the way from Carrollton to here. And in order to get from Carrollton to here, I had to follow directions from that point to point B. But the only way I could get here safely, I had to trust those lines that are in the road. I had to trust the sign when it said, go left instead of right. In order to get to this point, I trust what the lines say, trust what the signs say. But for some reason, we'll trust that and won't even trust what the Word of God says. Can I bring it a little closer? We go to the doctor. Women and men. I'm going to use the men this time. Men, we go to the doctor and they say, well, you need to have a checkup. And we're going to refer you to go to this doctor. The doctor come in there and you tell him, take your clothes off, you'll take your clothes off. You'll take your clothes off, he tell you to bend over, you bend over. You ain't asked him for not one credential. But because he got a white coat on, got some glasses on his nose, you sit up there, you do exactly what he said, take your clothes off, bend over, and you said, go ahead, doctor. And you ain't asked him one thing, but you trust that he's a doctor. You got to trust the word of God. You may not see God, but you got to trust that what God says, it is what he said. You got to trust the Lord. But I like what he said, trust him, and also you have to do good. Too many times we only want to trust God when it benefits us. And when we get what we need or what we desire, then we forget about God. And we go back to doing what we've been doing. What is trust? Trust, trust. It's not only trust, it's insurance, but it's assurance. Come on, somebody. Blessed assurance. Jesus is what? If you got him, you don't need nothing else. Second Corinthians 1:9, Paul tells us not to trust in ourselves, but in God who raised it. Now, I question Paul. Paul, why would you tell us that? Paul's telling us that because he's telling us that we will fail our own selves. Yeah. Come on, somebody. Too many people have failed themselves. You put your trust in self. You put your trust in yourself that you're going to make the right decision and all end up with disappointment and you start blaming yourself. Yeah. Baby, if I just put the thought a little bit long, I shouldn't have done that. Not only the Bible tells us not to put our trust in man because it fails us, but Paul said, don't put our trust in ourselves. Well, amen, somebody. We have to trust God. You have to trust God. What is trust? Let me just take one more thing. I'll move on. Trust is, I remember my son when he was about 2 or 3 years old. And he's always been a daring child. No matter what, he has no fear. If he comes to the swimming pool, he wants to dive in. Can't swim, but he wants to dive in. He's daring. And I used to put him up high on something, and I tell him to jump. He trusts that daddy is going to catch him. And he don't think twice about it. Jump for it. He jumped and I catch him. Only thing I'm trying to get you to see, you got to trust God. When daddy said do it, you got to trust that the Lord said he's going to make a way. Not only do I see, here he says trust, godly advice gives us to trust him, but then he says delight yourself also in him. Delight yourself. What is delight? Delight. Pleasure. It's pleasure. It's happiness, joy, it's glee, it's gladness, it's excitement. Delight yourself in the Lord. I just want to ask a question. You don't have to say nothing, but if you can, you can say something. If this is beneficial, how many would delight to walk into the house of the Lord today? How many was delighted? I mean, woke up, matter of fact, before you got up this morning. I remember mama when I was growing up, mama would get up singing hymns in the house and tell y'all, get up and get ready for church. But she'd be singing through the house, talking about, if it had not been the Lord on my side. She got up talking about, he's a lily of the valley and a bright and morning. So I wish I had some help here. Mama used to get up and talk about, if you're talking about Jesus, he's a friend. I wish I had some help here. I remember mama says that, if you trust in him, he'll make a way for you. Mama sing those hymns early in the morning before she got to the church. We got to learn how to delight ourselves when we come to the house of God. God don't want no quiet Christian. He wants a noisy Christian. He wants some folks that's going to make some noise in the house. He said, my house shall be called a house of prayer. If you're sick, you ought to come. come to the house of God. If you got something to think for, you ought to come together and assemble yourselves. Hebrews 10:25 said, assemble yourselves together for not forsaking yourself. Don't try to stay at home. Amen. Come to church and praise and worship God. Amen. You have to delight yourself also in the Lord. Now look what it says here. In the beginning, he says, trust in the Lord and do good. But then he goes back in the next, he said, delight yourself also in the Lord. Everything is still with the Lord.
Yeah.
Right. Suggests to me that we cannot make it without God.
Yeah.
Am I right about it?
Yeah.
We got to delight ourselves in the Lord. The Bible says that Luke writes in chapter 10:27, love thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy strength. He's talking to us. That we got to love God. We have to delight ourselves in the God. Don't put all your delight in your loved ones. Don't put your delight in your child, your delight in your finances, delight in your material thing. You have to put your delight in the Lord. You want to love God before you love anything else. First, he said, seek first the kingdom of God. And then all those other things will be added unto you.
Yes.
Come on, somebody.
Yes.
We need to learn how to delight ourselves in the Lord. It says it right there, delight yourself in the Lord, and he shall, look what it says here. He said, he shall give you the desire of your,
heart.
Of your what?
Heart.
He says your heart. See, we delight ourselves, but we're not getting anything.
Amen.
Because we're not delighting ourselves in the right things.
Amen.
Come on, somebody. He said, delight yourself in the Lord. He said, and then when you do this, I will give you, come on, somebody, the desire. Some of you got some desire. We all got some desire, but it's got to be in the will of God. And if it's in the will of God, he said, I give you some desire of your heart, but you got to submit yourself unto the Lord. See, somebody delight yourself into the Lord. I wish I had time to deal with it. So what happens is, because sometimes we want to delight ourselves and we want the things that God, that we want, but sometimes it ain't what God wants us to have.
Yes. Yes.
It does not mean that you're supposed to stop delighting.
Yes.
Come on, somebody. It ought to make you want to love him more.
Yes.
Come on. Yeah, the Lord wants us to love him and appreciate him. And when you wake up early in the morning, he wants you to wake up and say, Lord, thank you. For another day. He wants to know that you depend on him to wake you up each one. He wants you to delight yourself. He wants you to wake up, go through the days, and Lord, thank you for bringing me through the day. He wants you to give him the praise. This is for the righteous who've been vindicated. Listen, let me only end this. Listen, not only do I see the trust in the Lord, but he says, delight yourself in the Lord. But watch this. And the next he said, commit thy way unto the Lord.
Amen.
Commit thy way.
Uh-huh.
Now, your way unto the Lord. In other words, he said, whatever you're doing,
amen,
you ought to make it with the Lord.
Amen.
In other words, don't deviate from him,
amen,
but go to him. Look what he says here. He said, delight yourself, commit thy way unto the Lord. What is that? He said, pledge or bind. He's saying here that you have to commit to a policy that is right. You have to pledge and devote yourself. You have, not only that, but you have to apply yourself. You have to give yourself. You have to dedicate yourself. He says, commit your way unto the Lord.
Amen.
In other words, you cannot expect what God has for you when you're not committing to God.
Amen.
Now, you may not like it. I may not see it again, but thank you, Pastor Davis, for giving me the okay to preach the way you say, the way I preach. So let me go ahead and say it. You cannot say that you're committed to the church when you're not giving to the church.
Amen.
to him. You have to go by the curtain of the policies of what God has mandated.
Yeah.
You just read in your worship guide about the church covenant. That is a policy. That is a covenant. That is a promise that you have made to God that you're going to support the ministry. That means commit thy way. But something caught my attention in this passage here because it said commit your way unto the Lord. And when I kept reading, I saw this quotation mark there. And after it, it says, trust also in him. Y'all see that there? He said, trust in the Lord. So, but what got my attention, Pastor Davis, was that he said, trust the Lord here. But I said, he just told us that in verse 3. And then I go back, he says, commit thy way and trust in the Lord. See, some of us will trust in the Lord, try to do good, but we're not doing no committing. Come on, come on. It's just like I walk down the aisle with my wife and tell her, baby, I do commit to you, but when I get back outside from the altar, I start doing everything that I used to do. If you're going to commit, you got to commit. Change and change until it changes. If you want to commit thy way, you got to trust in the Lord and also do good. He says, commit thy way unto the Lord. And so I got kind of excited when I saw this, commit your way to the Lord and trust also in him. And then he says, he shall bring it to pass. All those things that he said preceding this, the desires of my heart. He's going to bring it to pass. He says that if I trust in him, that I shall be fed. If I only commit my way, if I only take the advice of God, that the Lord will hear my cry. Am I right about it? But the only way this can happen is I first got to trust in him. When it seemed like all hope is gone, I got to still trust in him. When the doctor has done all that he said he can do, I still got to trust in the Lord. Am I right about it? When my bank account is low, even right now, I got to trust in the Lord. And I wonder, is there anybody here like me, regardless of what my situation is, that I still trust in him? But not only do I still trust in him, but while I'm trusting, I still got to submit myself to him. I got to come to the church like everything is well with me. And I know some of you this morning, you look pretty good today. You look like everything is all right going on in your life. But behind closed doors, I know some of you got some things going on. Am I right about it? But I stopped by to give you some godly advice that keep on trusting God. Keep on submitting yourself and keep on committing yourself because God, he
He's not a liar. He said he'll do what he said he'll do. If he will make a way, I know he'll make a way. If he'll open doors, I know he will open doors. Am I right about it? I got to tell you right now, as I go on with my testimony, that I know that the Lord will make a way somehow. I've been up and I've been down, but somehow the Lord, he stayed around. Yeah, and I'm so glad that I put my will and my way in his way, because if it had not been, trust him, he'll make a way for me. Yes, he did. He opened some doors for me that no man can close. I've been last, but thank God he made me first. That's the kind of God we have today. And if I can leave something with you, I tell you to trust God today. Take the advice of what the word saying, for he will. I said he will. I wish I had some help. He will. He will. I know he will. I want somebody to testify with me. If you're not too ashamed to testify, if you know God will make a way, just wave your hand at me and say, I know he will make a way. I'm reminded when I was a little boy, mama used to say, how do you know he'll make a way? And she will holler out, I tried him. That we might have right to the tree of life. How many know he's all right? Don't fool me now. Come on, do you really know he's all right? He's all right with me. I want you to testify to yourself as that I know he's all right with me. I know what he's broke me from. I know what he's done for me. No matter, I accepted Jesus at an early age. But I messed up along the way. And see, something about messing up along the way, it helps me to tell you what God can do. See, if you ain't never messed up, how can you help somebody else? That's just like a single woman trying to tell a married woman how to take care of her husband. But if you've been there and done that, then you can be a help to somebody else. And because I've been there and done that, then I can tell somebody what God can do. Not what I can do, but what God can do. I want to offer Christ to you. If I may. There might be somebody today who's been disconnected from God. Today you can be reconnected by the advice that I've given you. I don't know where you went wrong, but God said you can come back home. The old church said we rededicate our lives to Him. And if that's you today, we want you to come. Maybe you never accepted Jesus as your personal Savior. There's an opportunity to say, I confess Christ. I know that He lived, died, and rose from the grave. Romans 10 and tell us that we shall be saved if we only believe. Amen. If that's you today, if you stand in need of prayer, special prayer, we want to pray with you and agree with you today.